Let's go.
Okay, so we come to the second day of this first part. And the next speaker is Daniel Peralta-Salas. And the title is Panoramic View of Steady Euler.
So, first of all, I want to thank Pierre and Pierre-Antoine for organizing this workshop under such strange circumstances. So, of course, I've given several talks after the pandemic by streaming, let's say online talks, but it's far from being the same, so I'm very happy to be real again. So, thank you for this opportunity. And it's a pleasure to be in Banjuls for the first time. And I hope you will find of interest my talk, although maybe it's a bit far from the topics that we work here. So I'm going to talk about steady Euler flows. It's an introductory talk. So please interrupt me at any moment if you want to ask or to comment or something. No problem. So let's start. Steady Euler flows. Just an overview, because of course there are many things to say about this subject. So the context of my talk, the ambient space where I'm going to work, is a Riemannian manifold. So MV, the manifold M, involved with a Riemannian metric V. The manifold does not need to be compact. It may have even boundary. Although in this talk, I will focus mainly on Euclidean space and the torus, but it may be any three manifold, but it's important that it's dimension three. Okay, for physical reasons, it's fluids appear in physics, and it's considered in general dimension three, although you can define equations and most of the problems make sense in any dimension. I will say something about this later. And so in this context, we have a fluid flow, which is, I will assume that it's inviscid, so no viscosity. This means that there is no internal friction and incompressible. This is sometimes known as ideal fluid flow and also actually constant density. But the name usually this is referred as ideal fluid flow. And fluid is modeled, is described by the Euler equations, which were already written in the 18th century. Of course, not on any Riemannian manifold. Riemannian geometry didn't exist by then, but it was written in Euclidean space. But of course, it has a generalization in this context, and the equations have the following. So it's a system of PDE, depends on time, it's an evolution system. So it's the following. So you have okay, and it's usually provided with an initial condition. So what's this? So here, the unknowns of this problem are u. U depends on space, on the volume of the manifold, and time. And it's a vector field. It's a non-autonomous vector field on the manifold. This is one of the unknowns of the problem. Non-autonomous vector field on our space, on M. Okay, so general depends on time, of course. And there is another unknown in this problem, which is E. It's the pressure. It's a scalar function. It's a scalar function. Also depending on time. this physical interpretation of U is, this is the velocity field of the fluid flow. U is the velocity field. So if you integrate, if you compute the integral terms of this velocity field, you get the fluid paths, the lines of the fluid flow follow. Okay. And P is the pressure, the inner pressure of the fluid. And it's the only force that I am considering here. Of course, you can add. And here, this is like Newton's law. This is the acceleration, and this is the force. Acceleration equals force. That's Newton's
law.
Oh, this is the covariant derivative of U along U. So you have a metric, Riemannian metric, you have a connection, and this is covariant derivative. Yes. Derivative. Velocity v u along u. Okay. Usually, in fluid context, where you work in our Euclidean space, this is written in the Euclidean space, this is written this way. If you break it, u, this is a first order operator, just in coordinates, something like u1, partial 1. U2 partial 2, U1 partial 1, plus U3 partial 3, applied to U. This is in the Euclidean context. The generalization to any manifold is just the covariant derivative, so you need to compute the derivative of the metric, the Christoffel symbols. Yes. And, of course, yes, let me explain, this is the gradient. Gradient of the pressure, it's computed with a metric. It's a vector field computed with this G, that's why you give the metric. It's not just a topological object, it's not just a manifold, it's with a metric. And this object here, this is the divergence operator. And this condition here, the variance being equal to zero, is just this incompressibility condition. Let's replace it here. So the variance equal to zero is the same more geometric words if you want. It's the same as the mean derivative of the volume being zero. The mean derivative. If you compute the mean derivative mu e with respect to u, this is here, and this mu e is the volume portion. It's the remaining. Okay, so it's the same. It's volume per serving. Or in other words, the flow, if you have u, u is e, it defines a non-autonomous flow, at least for some time. Flow, local flow. Non-autonomous, you have to give an initial time, let's say zero, flow. Then this condition is the same as that this flow is volume preserving. Okay, so this is equivalent, volume preservation and preservation. Okay? Yes?
That's time t equals the whole.
Yes.
And then for function p, you can take any function p.
Oh, no, no. Mm. Yes, good question. Thank you. Mm. So I said, yes, u, both u and p are unknowns of the problem. P is not here from the beginning. But the point is that at t equals 0, you recover the pressure from the u naught. So how do you do this? So you have this equation. Write this again. Ut plus derivative u mu equal minus gradient p. So let's compute here the divergence. The variance of this equation. Let's do the divergence of this. Divergence. And restrict, let's say, to t equals zero. So the variance is a space derivative. This is time, you can do this. So divergence of u is zero for all time, so this term doesn't appear here. So you have this object, the variance of gradient of now u. Now you are restricting, so it's u naught, and this is equal to minus the variance of gradient is Laplacian, so minus Laplacian of the p naught. You want the pressure at time t at time zero. So you have this equation on mg, and you can invert the Laplacian. Then usually, for example, if you consider closed manifold, compact or watery, then there exists a unique solution of this problem up to constant, because the only harmonic functions on compact manifold are constants. So usually, or even if you are in R3 with decay in some solid space or whatever, this has a unique solution up to constant. This implies a unique p naught up to constant, up to adding a constant. So this is your p naught. It's not, you don't give the p naught from the beginning. It's already given, it's already computed, you can already compute it from the u naught. So you don't need to, it's restricted. And this freedom of the constant is not important. Yes, there's always, of course, a freedom of the constant.
And after, it's the same as every time?
And then, it goes the solution, and then you can recover with the Laplacian for each time. So it's indeed an unknown of the problem, but they are quite related to this. So this is the problem. As I said, this makes sense on any dimension. Just a remark. You can write this equation on any dimension. Equations are the same on any dimension n. Okay, something the same equation. So you consider the derivative, the quasi derivative for an n dimensional manifold. But I will focus here on dimension 3. So the problem of usually in fluid mechanics is that you have an initial condition on your manifold. Your manifold is usually a very specific manifold, it could be within a space with initial condition, in this case passed in half and infinity, or it could be the torus, three-dimensional torus with flat metric and with a smooth initial condition, or in some solid space. And you want to understand the evolution of this, but of course first the question is if this exists for all time, or if it, even if you start with a smooth initial condition, can it develop singularities or that? So this problem is open in general. I mean, it's not known if you start with an initial condition that is smooth on the torus, for example, if after some time it will go up, it will develop singularities. Okay, that's an open problem. So I'm going to focus here on this context, steady Euler flow. It is an equilibrium situation, and it's the easiest possible solutions that one can consider to this problem, or even to a general evolution of PDE, which is when the unknowns don't depend on time. It's a stationary situation. Okay, so let's focus now this situation, steady or stationary. Okay, stationary solutions. It is like equilibrium points in the same space, infinite dimensional space of vector fields, of the variance free vector fields, where this defines dynamics, let's say. You're just considering like the equilibrium points, right? The rest points are given by stationary solutions. And so this means u does not depend on time. Also v, of course. So in this case, an equation, you just drop the time-dependent term. It's just a covariant derivative of u along u is equal to minus weight of some function, the pressures, and of course, compressibility condition. The variance of u is equal to zero. And this is is the system that I'm going to study and going to discuss in this talk, for the rest of the talk. Let's forget about the time dependence. So now here, this is an autonomous vector field. This is a time independent vector field on the manifold. X, autonomous vector field. So it's a dynamical system, and if, for example, your manifold is compact, it defines a global flow from that. So if you want to study, and it's compressible, it's flowing per second, you want to study the dynamics of this, what sort of dynamics, or let's say in the language of this workshop, how wide the dynamics of a vector field with this constraint, not any vector field, should be satisfying this strange.
What is the constraint? If you have any vector field, then you can write.
No, not any vector field satisfies this equation. Okay. Well, first it has to be only preserved in some mind condition.
So I can find P as a solution of your equation?
Not any vector field. Not any volume preserving vector field satisfies or can be found this P. Yes, I tell you an abstraction, for example. It's not completely understood which volume preserving fields satisfy this for some metric. This is a bit new. But we know some structures. This is one of the most important. And there is, of course, in, thank you for the question, because there's a sort of dichotomy. One possibility, which is weaker, is let's study in a vector field that satisfies this PDE for some metric. Metric is not fixed a priori, but you can find the metric from the vector field, so that's a weaker condition. But usually the metric is fixed. It's a flat metric on the torus, so that's much more rigid. If the metric is fixed, then of course generically if you have any vector field and fixed metric, you will do this, it's not a problem. But yes, I'll tell you this in more detail. But I want to write this in an equivalent way, this equation. So an equivalent way of writing this is this one. If you compute the curl of u. Now I'm going to explain this. So this is compute the equivalent. So what's the curl of u? This is, here you have several objects. B is a function. This is the so-called Bernoulli function. Very important in mechanics. This is p plus 1/2 u squared. This is the Bernoulli function. Yes. And so what's the curl? This is standard. In the Euclidean space, this is just a standard rotational or curve operator. It's called the vorticity. Vorticity is very important in fluid mechanics. This object is another vector field computed for u, called u. And in the context of general Riemannian manifold, this is defined this way. So if you contract. So you have the volume form, it's a free form, so you contract the curl of u, it's a two form. The definition of this curl of u is that this must be equal to the differential, to the exterior derivative of alpha, where alpha is the dual with the metric of u. So if you want to compute curl of u for u, then you compute the one form, dual to alpha. This is a beta, this musical isomorphism between k gives and forms using the metric. This metric is fixed in metric space. So you use the metric. And you compute alpha, then you take the exterior derivative with such a form. And now the only vector field, the unique vector field that satisfies this identity is a global field. It's unique because this is not generated, it's a volume. There is an only and unique vector field that satisfies this. So this is the definition of global field that in the Euclidean space, in the standard in R3 with flat metric, is just the coordinate expression that that students.
Could you say again what is mu of G?
This is the volume form. Germanian volume.
Germanian volume?
Yeah, as I said, so you have the metric. So
okay.
You compute the determinant, the metric, square root, the determinant, and the Germanian volume. So it is a free form. You contract this interior.
And what, like, so what you are defining the alpha? Like, this equation is to define the alpha?
No, alpha is given. Alpha is the. So you have u, so alpha is just a one form dual. Okay, so this is given because you have. So this is to compute. Let's say you want.
So alpha is equal.
Something like this. Shell of u is defined.
So alpha is equal to g of u dot.
Something. Yeah. So alpha acting on field alpha dot. Let's say is g
of u, dot.
U dot.
Okay.
It's yeah.
And so you define like this the curl of u.
And did you find yeah. Right. And the coordinates is the usual in the Euclidean space.
Is it specific to dimension 3 or like for solid
Yes, you can, yeah, this is very specific for dimension 3, this definition, but you can define the vorticity, the curl in general for any dimension, yes, sure. Yeah. So, but it's more difficult because the operator is non-linear. So, in any dimension, let's say a remark. Yes, you can define the same way, L of U, mu g, let's say dimension 2 n plus 1, odd dimension. So then in odd dimension, the definition is the alpha n times. So this means the alpha wedge in alpha, which is alpha n times. So this is a 2n form, right? 2n form, yeah. And this is a 2n form, so this defines the curl of u in any dimension odd, yes. And in dimension even, this is a vector field, but in dimension even dimension, 2, 4. The vorticity, the curl, is a function, it's no longer a vector field. Because it's a difference. It's just divided the d alpha n by mu g. So in any in dimension even, in dimension 2n, if you compute d alpha n times, it's already a 2n form. So you divide by the volume. You have to understand division by in the way as this 2n form, 2n form, it's just a factor. And this is the vorticity in dimension, this is a function. And it's the kernel of vorticity. Yes. So there's a difference between even dimension and odd dimension. In even dimension, vorticity is a scalar. In odd dimension, vorticity is a field. But they both enjoy a very nice property of transport that I'm going to talk about. But it satisfies the same sort of conditions, but it's much more difficult to analyze in dimension 4 or higher because of the nonlinear definition. Yeah, it's more complicated. Yeah. But it still makes sense. Sure. So, and I didn't tell you what vector product means in any dimension. Vector product of 2, 3, not in the dimension, in dimension 3. Yes, this way of writing the equation here is very 3D. This is very 3D dimension. The curve makes sense in any dimension, but here I'm using vector product. Vector product is very.
But like B's look like the energy of the fluid. that B looks like the energy. It looks like the energy. But is that constant then?
It is a first integral, but it's not.
Because you, but it's not constant. It's a first integral, okay.
Yeah, I told you now, yesterday. It is a first integral. If it's constant everywhere, it's then what is called a coming field, but yeah, I'm telling you now. So vector product,
yeah.
That's the definition. So vector product, that's where so you have vector product on three dimensions. So you have x, y, two vector fields, then the vector product, x cross y. This is defined. If you compute the contraction of x and then of y of UE, so this is a one form, right? 3, 2, 1. So this must be equal. So this is a one form dual to the vector product. So this is the definition. Vector product, xy. Actually, if you want, you can reverse and say this is a one form. You do the opposite, you write the index, you compute the vector field directly. This is the definition of vector product. With Euclidean metric, it is simply a vector, usual vector product in R3. Simply that. And this is what appears here. This could be Q and Galloping. Dimension 3. Sorry, 3 dimension. Okay? So these are the equations, the stationary equations. So which are the questions on this problem or on this setting? Mm-hmm. Okay, so the problem is, what I said is to understand, trying to understand the dynamics of vector fields that satisfy or that are steady Euler flows. So in this setting, as I said, there are two possibilities. So one possibility is that the metric is fixed the metric from the beginning, is what happens in physics. In physics, usually the metric is the Euclidean metric in R3. Or a flat metric on the dots. You are not allowed to change it. So if the metric is fixed, and the metric is fixed. For example, it could be if you want to compact manifolds S3 with the round metric, the canonical metric, or in fluid mechanics. Usually one considers T3, the three dots with the flat metric, etc. Then one expects some sort of rigidity in the behavior. So there are a few global solutions. So you have this PDE constraint. So it's the variance of u equals 0, of course, but you have this other condition that you can write in several ways, for example, this one, u where u equals the gradient of a function. So this defines an infinite dimensional space. And so if you consider the space of the various PDE fields, fixed metric, it's an infinite collimation. This is a constraint, one PDE constraint, so it defines infinite collimation. It's a very small space in the space of the radius field. If the metric is fixed. So
So you want to compare body pressure dynamics with steady order flow dynamics, is what you would like. But it's a global constraint. Yeah, it's local in the sense that it's point wise constraint, but defined everywhere. Yes, I found the problem. And so it's point by point, so then it's so generically at a very few field. If you compute this object here, it won't be a gradient.
Right, I guess the question of François is if you have the germs of vector of conservative vector field, can it satisfy mathematically your view or not? Just if you have a germ.
Yeah, sure.
Can find locally your big which satisfies this.
It has a lot of constraints, algebraic constraints, so that's why I said infinite correlation.
But locally, a conservative vector field does not need to have a B. You can have
No.
Okay.
Not for the metric, for the fixed metric.
No. Okay.
If you're allowed to change the metric, yes, of course, because.
Okay.
At least if you are in a not rest point of the field, any field at a non zero point is straight. So straight is constant, let's say, in some coordinates. So in these coordinates, of course, it is steady or flow. But the metric is no longer, I mean, when you straight the flow of theorem, it's not adapted to the metric. So even locally, there are constraints, many constraints in this setting, in the fixed metric setting. That's why I said rigidity. You can enter it, but it's not, if you compute U cross scale of U with the metric that is fixed, it's not a gradient.
Why?
Because you can find an example and you compute that it's not a gradient. Like, for example, but the scale of U depends on U. It's a nonlinear equation. So in particular, I wanted to say this later, but again.
Not every vector field is a gradient.
No, of course.
Because, for instance, the rotational, so the curl is necessarily zero, for instance, I guess. No?
Yes. This is satisfied for some metric. This is true. But maybe this is what you have in mind. It is a metric, local metric. You make it, but it's not the linear metric or the round metric or whatever. It's not fixed. It's, for example, if you compute the curl of this, I'm going to tell you this later. I want to say something, but now I am going to tell you something. So this is if the metric is fixed. I mean, that's for this, is just write any vector field that you want. A, B, C. Any functions, compute this, the curl of U. Compute U cross curl U. Almost surely, this will not be aware. This is the main reason why this is not satisfied. Just write an example. Of course, if U is linear, yes, of course, it's curl of U is U. If you do that, it's an infinite. And actually, if you do the German stuff that you say, which means just paper expanding at a point, if you do that, you will see a hierarchy of algebraic conditions satisfied by these constraints. The coefficients, you expand A as polynomial, as a constant, plus A1x, plus whatever quadratic group, compute curl of U with the fixed metric, with the flat metric, for example. It's mystery, it is very important. That's why I'm telling you now this a lot of fixed or not fixed. Then you see several constraints. A dot C equal to theory. But it's true, which is probably your intuition, that if you allow if the metric is not fixed, if you are not interested in the particular including a metric or round metric or whatever, then there is more flexibility.
Yes.
So more flexibility. This metric is not fixed, which gives rise to the following definition. So in particular, locally, any vector field in a neighborhood of a non-zero point, it's void. Any vector field in a neighborhood of non-zero is void. When the metric is not fixed. So there is this definition. But this sort of extension is more in the geometric studies of fluid flows, let's say. So for people in fluid mechanics, it's this context what appears because they are interested in the Euclidean metric in R3 of this group. So
if you have any U, even the zero make no problem?
Probably in the second. When U matches, if locally any. No, I don't think. If it's not zero, yes, for walks or that. But if it matches, if the point is not degenerate, hyperbolic, then it's okay with you. At least in some C ones are. Well, of course, you have always a constraint of the range string. Of course, this is there, but.
If you are non-metric, then not to define divergence.
Yeah, if you have sink or source, then you have similarity. It could not be the range string, yes. So you don't allow for sinks or sources here, yeah, it's conservative dynamics. Unless you want singularities, some delta. But here I'm considering just smooth everywhere solutions. Yeah. So always you must have in mind conservative dynamics, like volume preserving, but even with the constraint of volume preserving, and you're interested in understanding which dynamics can be altered or not. Yeah. So this is the problem. So this is a definition. So volume preserving. Field M is polarized fluid. If there exists a metric, so it's not this a priori, there exists a minor metric, fundamental, such that U is a steady order of flow. On M. Okay, so Euler isolated, and this is here you are introducing an extra parameter somehow, which is metric, so it's not a number, it's an infinite dimensional space of objects, it's a metric space. So one expects, that's why I said more flexibility, one expects that many more fields that are not steady Euler for the Euclidean metric, for example, will be steady Euler for some other metric. This is what one expects.
What is it, volume or?
Volume, yeah, volume, you fix the volume. It's not very important because for this thing compartmental, you need two volumes are isotopic, like most of them, as far as they integrate the same constant. But yeah, you fix the volume. And yes, usually one consider that the volume is the Riemannian volume. That's true. There is a realization of this definition where you allow for the volume not to be exactly the Riemannian one. This is possible in this definition. But here I'm always considering that that this volume is the Riemannian volume. But you can realize it. So an example. related to something that here has been interested today. It's a universal form. So in particular, if you have a surface, sigma 2, sigma 2, and you consider this E1, so unit tangent function, then this is a free manifold, this time is free. And the geodesic flow, this sigma 2 is symmetric. Then the field here, the field in this free manifold, it's a steady order. It's polarizable. So any dynamics that you can have for the basic field, you can have it for this polarizable. And also for when.
And is there some Euclidean free manifold? Which have been the metric for which the Euler flow on it is.
Yeah.
Is there is one that you can try?
It's been those. Constant field. Any constant field is. Say A, B, C. These are constants. This is. Even though this is probably.
Okay.
This is
sensitive.
Actually, it's a
relation.
Yeah, in yellow view is zero, actually. If you compute with the flat, this is with flat paper. It's rotational. Actually, this is the basis of the three harmonic views. So this is Euler, not only Euler S, but this is Euler for the flat metric. Any linear flow from the three toes is.
My question was, those you can find some earlier Euclidean earlier flow as a geodesic flow?
Yeah, this is a geodesic.
It's not completely geodesic. Yes?
Oh, because of the parameterization, you mean?
Yeah, but like, the point is not moving, for instance, like in a. Ah, yes.
But geodesic means geosymmetric.
Okay, sorry. Yeah.
This. And it's right, but not only. That there is a metric here, the metric is just a flat one. It satisfies the equation with the flat one. So this is the simplest.
I missed what is the geodesic mode?
It's a vector field such that there is a metric. This is a metric that makes all orbits geodesics. I'm parameterized to this, if you want. I mean, that does not need to be unit length with the
points. So, geodesic up to.
Up to parameterization. Right. Parameterization is what we do. Up to. To parameterize. I don't rely on it. Up to. So, from this observation,
For geodesic flow, like the base point is moving, like this is the case. In, like T3 is not even a T1 of it's not a unit tangent.
No, it's not of this type. But for the flat metric,
this is an example of Euler flow, but it's not a geodesic. It's not a geodesic flow.
It's not of the type of unit tangent model, but it is yes. It is a field such that on the free flow there is a metric for which each line, which is straight line, is a just, of course, it's a straight line. So it satisfies this definition. It's not a unit planning number. That's why, if you want, call this an example. Also, another example is S3, the free sphere with the round metric. And hopefully, which in mechanical terms is, for example, if you have two harmonic oscillators in the same frequencies, then each energy level would use different of duration. Then this is again geodesic with respect to all the lines and the circles, and this is actually a steady order problem. On this specific end, of course, it's the wrong end. It's the wrong end. And this is a species. You can write the solution. It's something like squared root. If you define a sphere as a unit of sphere in R4, then you can write a U, which is something like minus. Which is tangent to the spheres in R4. This is rotation and rotation, right? Minus S2 is 1, minus S4 is 3. Rotations in this R2 plane, rotation in this R2 plane. This is tangent to S3. Tangent to S1 square. And it satisfies the equation on the ground. It's another example. Everything is pretty good. So, yes. So, we can have a couple of properties of the theory of the flows. It's what you asked, so it's about the Bernoulli function. So yes, the Bernoulli function is a first integral. So B is the first integral of U, say, the flow. And the reason is very simple, it's just it comes from the equation. So U dot, U cross U probability B. So let's multiply U dot product, square root.
I don't understand what is a first integral for something which is steady.
It's just a function that satisfies this that U dot greater than B is equal to 0, or in other words, if you want, B, if you compute the flow, so U defines the flow, the dimensional, right? So if you compute B along the flow, it's constant. Yes. This is simply what I say to be first integral. It's a constant of the motion, constant of the motion. Yeah, it makes sense for autonomous fields. Yeah. Steady doesn't mean that the dynamics of space means that the field defines integral errors. So it's just a function. So if you compute the level sets, equal or constant, the lines of U, the integral errors of U, they are tangent to the level sets. That's simply what I mean by it, or what is meant by first integral. Although, of course, this E may be trivial, it may be a constant, then it works. So this is what usually is referred as laminar behavior. So it's integrable in some sense. So this is the first property, which is very important. So which already tells you there's a constraint. Okay? So about the constraint of any order, any flow, or any conservative flowing preserving flow can be the Euler. Okay. If it doesn't have a global of a single law, then but it would imply that this B must be constant everywhere. So the steady Euler flows are integral in some sense. Yes?
For example, if the flow is transitive, there is dense body. Does it imply that B is not
everywhere? If it has a dense orbit, you mean? Yeah. In such a case, yes, such a flow should be of the Beltrami type. It's possible, it can be steady, so, and then the second property is and
fiber, fine wire, and dry. Precisely, is UK is of the form E2 times in the row. And there are like a triangle coordinates, which are this UK, where U is UK in these coordinates. And it's equal to this integral in this sense, it's something else. So this one was. So the picture of this is just so you have to manifold. So away from some set that is not very bad. Actually, this set is simply the critical level set of the Bernoulli function. So you can consider the prime edge of the critical values. And being everything analytic, this set is really good. So the edge one, so away from this small set, you have this creation like line. In the case that the Bernoulli function is a constant, of course, if it's constant. So this is analogous to the integral system,
What is the Euler stuff in this statement?
Okay,
this
is
Euler
and
it's Euler. It's a solution.
It's a solution. So then there is just in order to finish. Wanted to tell you much more that this is you more or less got some interest in this, it's fine for me. So this leads to a dichotomy, which is Beltrami or laminar. So this Arnold's structural theorem. This is, let's say, describing laminar behavior of the fluid, if you understand it this way. But of course, a key assumption here, well, there is an analyticity, but okay, assuming everything is analytic, you may have that B is identically constant. B is a constant on N. So then if B is constant, it's zero everywhere, gradient constant. So this is, this gives rise to the definition of Beltrami field, which is a vector field such that kernel of U is proportional to U. The U is parallel to kernel of U because of this condition, so kernel of U is proportional, it's U. So this is the definition of Beltrami field, and actually this function f, this f. This is actually a first integral also of the of U, because if you compute the variance of kernel of U, this is the variance of F U. So the variance of kernel is always zero. And the variance F U is greater than F dot U plus F. The variance of U, which is zero again,
So this gives us gradient f plus u is 0. So f is the first integral. It's a function such that the dynamics lie in the level sets. So if you want, for example, to construct a steady Euler flow which is ergodic, or it has a length topologically transitive or tensor with whatever, you are not certainly in this situation, because this situation leads to invariant torii. You don't want invariant torii. You don't want a variation of invariant torii. It's not of this type with f non-constant, because it's again a first integral. So this ergodicity or complicated behavior, let's say, can only happen for what are called strong Beltrami fields. But sometimes this strong word is deleted. Strong Beltrami fields. Which satisfy that the curl of u is equal to lambda. So lambda is a constant, not zero constant. Okay, strong properties. And then this equation is in principle compatible with this more complicated behavior or with the existence of sort of chaos or whatever. So, if you want, but of course, I want to point out that both situations could coexist in principle, because here Arnold assumes analyticity. So, being analytic function, and everywhere analytic function is given, it can be reproduced from the function just in a small neighborhood. But if you consider C infinity solutions or CK solutions, you could have some regions of integrability, of course. And there are examples. You could have the C infinity setting. So you could have a part of the manifold that is foliated by invariant torii and sort of integrability.
Just a question, like, so Beltrami field is a particular solution of B equal constant.
It's a particular solution.
So it's not an application. If you have a Beltrami field, then it will be, we will have V equal to constant. And it will be also a solution.
It's equivalent, because V equal constant is this. This is
equivalent. Yeah.
But then this certainly implies this, of course. But if you want the converse, for example, the converse is very easy if you assume that u does not vanish. For example, u non-vanishing from n, any point n, then of course, if two fields are parallel, curl of u is proportional to u because u does not vanish. If u has zeros, not so clear.
And regarding the theorem of Arnold, what are the constraints on F1 and F2?
Yeah. Arnold's theorem does not fix the metric. Okay. Here the metric is not important, so it's something. It's some behavior for any metric, let's say. So here, actually, any build of this form.
It's very exhausting.
Locally, there is some metric for which it is.
But you have not even a compatibility. You should have some compatibility.
Global.
Like between the field torus, you have between the thick torus. I don't know how you say this. But like you should have some compatibility at least, no?
In this domain, for example. Mm-hmm.
No, yeah, like between the domain.
Oh yes. Globally, it's not to kind of prove this. Globally, it has to be satisfied.
And if.
For some metric, at least global. Yeah. Mm. Yes, you need to glue so that there is a global metric such that. Yeah.
Mm. Yes. And just to have the idea a little bit more clear, like if you take T2 times 0,1 and you take this one, a field like this, and you undo UK of the Euclidean metric, what should be F1z and F2z?
Oh, for the Euclidean,
for this flat manifold.
Yeah. Anything.
Anything would work for the Euclidean metric.
On this, two times 0, 1 with the metric which is
flat.
Yes, dx square. Sorry, d theta 1 square plus d theta 2 square plus d set square. Any field.
Of this form is a solution.
This form is a study over here. Another story is. You want to glue globally, but for example, if
and yet let me take it easier. No.
But for example, if you are in d2 times t, I mean t3 at the end of the day, this is global solution, flat metric, as far as it's periodic. Any periodic function, f1 set d theta 1 plus f2 set d theta 2, f1, f2 periodic. It's a steady Euler with a flat metric. Yeah. It's computation, just compute this equation. It's not Beltrami, I think, but compute. That's it. Yeah, it's integrable. So this has. So generically, you have a good setting for KM theory, right? It's integrable, and typically, you have twists or whatever. This is used. Some examples and
now
no structure at all on the functions.
Yeah. And now, if you take a torus and you embed it into R3, to which should be the form of the torus? Like, what should be the what should be the restriction of the vector field to be a solution of LR4?
What should it be? In S3, you mean? In the
R3, you just take R3 or S3, whatever, but like in our space. And you take a sick torus like this, and you take a tire and you put it in our space. What should be the restriction of the flow on the torus?
Do you want to
if it's down like this, you just take a buoy and you put it into space.
Then you have to check.
Is it more complicated? It's not.
It's more complicated. Yeah.
It's not like the geodesic flow. It should not be the geodesic flow in this part.
If it's not geodesic, even if it's not geodesic, if the metric is fixed, when you start, because here you don't glue anything, it's just you that need. If you want to glue several, or you do some diffeomorphism to glue or whatever, then the Euler equation with fixed metric at least is not very well behaved under this. Yeah. You have examples, for instance, in S3 with the round metric, where you have, you have the S3 minus the hop link. Okay, the one. Okay, so S3 minus this hop link is equal to P2 times 0, 1, right? If you want to, because you are, you see. So S3 minus hop link, it's a product of torus. And you have steady solutions with the round metric, globally defined on S3 of this form. Yes, you have steady solutions. But it's just one domain. I mean, you don't look. It's just a domain covering everything except for two exceptional fibers.
And like conversely of Arnold, if I take a vector field of this form, where I got a many field torus, like a sick torus, let's say, as that I glue together, on each of which we have this form, can we find a metric which works?
That's really interesting. So yes, with assumptions, but it's been answered very recently. It is a very nice paper. So let me do some advertisement of a paper of a student of Eva Miranda. You know Eva? Maybe you know her. She has a student called Robert Cardona. And he studies precisely this question. If you have on a three manifold, probably compact, no boundary, you have an integrable field, volume preserving, satisfying all these kind of constraints, invariant or whatever. and some assumptions on the singular, on the critical set of the function, something like Morse bot. Morse bot. So I mean, so Morse function. Well, a particular case is Morse function. So B, a particular case is B being a Morse function. Okay, which is okay. It's just non-generic critical point. A generalization is Morse bot. Which allows for a higher dimensional critical set, but still non-degenerate in the normal. So the Morse bot means that in this setting, and so of course you have the isolated critical points in the theory, but you could also have circles, critical points, as one. But the Hessian matrix, B, the Hessian matrix on the normal bundle, handled by each point, normal bundle, which is two dimensional, is non degenerate. Or you can have also two dimensional manifolds. For example, toroidal, and then the Hessian of the normal bundle. Now the normal bundle is one-dimensional. It's non-degenerate. Okay. So this is the definition of Morse bot. It's something that critical set does not need to be a point, as for Morse function. For Morse function, it's always a point. It is a submanifold embedded, a submanifold compact in this case because it's a compact manifold. And the non-degeneracy is on the normal. Okay, it's the best thing that you can have when you have a submanifold which is critical. So in this case of Morse bot or Morse, then he solved this problem. If you have a nonlinear function, Morse bot with some mild critical set, whatever, then there exists a metric adapted to the converse. Let's say converse of Arnold. For some metric, so it would fit within the definition of Eulerizable flow. It's not the metric; it's not fixed. It's more rigid. So I think I'll stop because I already time is over. So okay, thank you. Hope you enjoyed the video.
Any more questions?
You study stationary solutions. Can you study the stability of this?
Yeah, that's really good question. Okay, so so there is a criterion that you will like. So it goes back to the 90s, I think, Bishik, Friedlander, several people, that gives you a sufficient condition for a stationary flow to be unstable, not stable, unstable, linearly. Which is the existence of positive Lyapunov exponent. So if you have an equilibrium which is hyperbolic, then it will be linearly unstable. If you have a periodic orbit that is saddle type, it will be unstable. If you have an oscillatory flow, something with positive and negative also, because it's volume preserving. Lyapunov exponent. Then it's unstable. Always you have positive Lyapunov exponent, it's unstable, but linearly unstable. This means that the linearization of the Euler equation, which is nonlinear, it's unstable for true instability for the whole nonlinear system. It's more or less open. It's you have to ask something else. I mean, positive Lyapunov exponent is okay. Something that, that is a good condition, but not anything in principle can be unstable. So for instability, you know some things. For stability, I think in dimension 3, there is no example of a steady solution that you can prove that is stable. even linearly. So the candidate, okay, you must have zero Lyapunov exponent everywhere, and a candidate that many people believe that should be stable is the that I mentioned before, which is the Hopf vibration. I mean, it's a vector field such that all orbits are periodic. This should be stable from the Euler equation, or that's the conjecture, let's say, but it's not good. You need very simple dynamics. Or even if you have integrability, as far as you have monodromy between the, I mean, as far as you have twist, I mean, as far as this F1 and F2 change, which means can, I mean, which means periodic, quasi-periodic, periodic, quasi-periodic, this is also, it's a zero exponent, Lyapunov exponent, but there is another criterion which says that under this twist, it's also linearly unstable. So you need to have many, many dynamical quantities to be trivial. Lyapunov exponent, no twist. So that's why the candidate is this everything periodic, but it's open.
So to just a summary of your talk, you said so geodesic flow is realizable. It says that the strong Beltrami field is also a Beltrami field and is a solution of Euler. And you mentioned yesterday rib flow. Where does those...
because rib flow... yes, so rib flow is always
Beltrami
field.
So maybe you can record
the rib flow. Yes, there is a correspondence. In particular, any rib flow is geodesic. Okay. So you have, and this works on any dimension, actually, but okay, let's focus on dimension 3. So you have alpha, a contact 1-4, which means just the definition that if you compute this three form, which is alpha, which the alpha, this never vanishes. So it's positive, for example. So given this object, this one form, which exists on any three manifold, you compute the red flow field. Which is a vector field R that satisfies, is uniquely defined by these two equations. It's positive on the one form, so actually totally positive. It's normalized by the one form, alpha R is one. And it's in the kernel of the alpha. So the contraction of R to the alpha is zero. So this is just the definition of red field. So then the claim of the property. So there exists a metric, which is called compatible metric, such that if you compute the curl with respect to this metric of R, this is equal to R, or two alpha constant times R, you can normalize to be one. So then it's a stronger property of this metric, which is not unique. There are many strong properties. So any rep field is a Beltrami, so then in particular it's a steady solution for some metric. So any dynamics that you can have for rep flows, and there is a lot of literature on rep dynamics. You can have ergodic, for example, this question, and you have, I think, constructions of muscle structures of this kind of for rep. There are many other things. Immediately, it is a Beltrami flow for some metric, but that's the point. You gain a lot of generality because you have the rep freedom, I mean, you have the contact machinery. But so then you have flexibility, but then the metric depends on each. So this metric G depends on each alpha that you have, so it's not the same for you. So it's not fixed. So, for example, I can tell you there is another problem. And I finish. It's like a problem or conjecture of, you know, it's Williams, Robert Williams, Williams, Williams. So, yeah, so maybe Penn State, I don't remember. So there exists, so the question is, there exists steady order flow, steady order on metric is fixed, and which metric? The round metric on the street. He wants this manifold, not any metric, that contains all knots. Or knots in its streamlines. I mean, for any knot on the sphere, there exists streamline realizing this. This is the problem. Does there exist this? So this is solved if you drop this. I mean, if you only want some metric, this is solved. There exists some because there exists a rep field. Using template theory and universal templates and all that, there exists a red field that realizes all knots. A unique field has all knots inside its integral curves. So then, being red, it's Beltrami. Then there exists some metric, but it's not. It's not, or a priori, don't know if this is the round metric. So this is completely open. So this shows you somehow this dichotomy: rigidity, flexibility. Flexibility means that you move the metric, you can do many things. Rigidity is that these sort of problems are open when metric is restricted. Okay, so thank you.
Okay, so we take 10 minutes.
30 minutes more.